Welcome, visitor, to this production on Coolgardie, Western Australia. Coolgardie is located 550 kilometres west of Western Australia's capital city, City of Perth. It's adjacent to Kalgoorlie. The shire contains about 6,000 people and includes the cities of Kalgoorlie East and Kalgoorlie West. In the late 1890s, 15,000 people resided in Coolgardie and its two suburbs, Toorak to the north and Montana over the railway line to the south. Gavin Casey, Goldfield's born author, wrote, "Small though it is, Coolgardie is the greatest ghost town in Australia." Along Bailey Street today, with its occasional shop, between broken brick ruins, relics of bygone glory, it is still not difficult to realize that 60 years ago, this wide street echoed the voices of crowding pedestrians, the rattle of polished silkies, and the click of fine horses, the grind of heavy drays, and the almost silent plod of loaded camel trains. A more detailed map showing the location of Coolgardie relative to Kalgoorlie and Kalgoorlie . A map of the city, it's not very large. A Google view indicates that the buildings today are generally pretty small. Google reveals that an earthquake 4.5 in size occurred near Coolgardie in 1987, rated as a light earthquake. The discovery of gold in Coolgardie in 1892 led to prospectors departing from all over Australia to flock to Coolgardie. With the discovery of the new goldfield, an entire new gold rush began with thousands flocking to the area. By 1898, it was the third largest town in the colony with a population of 15,000 and another 10,000 in the surrounding region. At its peak, 700 mining companies based in Coolgardie were registered in London. The town also supported a wide variety of businesses and services. The value of Coolgardie to the colony of West Australia in the late 1890s was so significant that it was used as leverage to force WA to join Australian Federation. Britain and the Eastern colonies threatened to create a new state around Coolgardie and the other regional goldfields such as Kalgoorlie if the government in Perth did not agree to hold a referendum on federation. When federation did occur in 1901, Coolgardie was the center of a federal electorate, the Division of Coolgardie. Soon after, in November 1901, Alf Morgans from the state electorate of Coolgardie was elected Premier of Western Australia. Today, there's lots to see in Coolgardie, many of a historical nature. It's hard to believe that prisoners were chained to this gold tree in Coolgardie in its early days prior to the construction of a prison. Some of the earlier housing remains, as do most of the public buildings. a sketch of Coolgardie. Some of the attractions includes the Goldfields Exhibition Museum, which is excellent, Warden Finnerty's residence, the Pharmacy Museum, one of the best collections of pharmaceutical supplies in display in Australia, and the Railway Museum. There's also the historic cemetery, State Battery, Lions Lookout over the area, famous Wycorn bottle collection, and Ben Pryor's Park. The Bottle Museum is substantial. A popular attraction outside town is a tour of the State Battery. It's the only fully operational battery in the state and allows tours. You can see gold being extracted and pulled into bullion bars. The building was erected in 1902 and has been registered with the National Estate as a representative industrial building still in use. Looking around the town, there's still a frontier image. There's an operational camel farm providing rides, or you can hire camels for a trek through the outback. And the plaques are interesting. For instance, the ruins of the old Marble Bar Hotel, 1897. This is all that is left of the Marble Bar, whose reputation was such that it found a place in the memory of nearly every pioneer resident of Coolgardie. The reasons for its popularity were numerous. It supplied good, cheap meals. The owners were always prepared to give a free meal to a prospector down on his luck. Everyone was made to feel welcome, irrespective of whether he was well-dressed or in dirty clothes. The sparkling ginger beer dispensed at the Marble Bar was a heady drink, believed to be associated with the fact that almost next door was a hotel. The importance of Coolgardie was such that it even rated postal stamps. Here's one cancelled with Coolgardie. The past lives on today in the Stars Public Building. Remnants of the past abound. A Coolgardie safe. It's not a safe, it's really a refrigerator provided as cooling by evaporating water from a hessian cloth on the sides. There's a lot of characters, old prospectors, old timers, and indigenous people in Coolgardie. A Coolgardie prospector pans and then crushes the ore in a dolly. Panning for gold. Local residents. A modern day miner relaxes. There's still gold to be found, and some prospectors make their living on the side by hunting for gold with metal detectors. These backyard prospectors don't make a lot of money, but they do live very cheaply. Occasionally in primitive conditions without the modern amenities that we're used to. An elder relaxes in the sun with his spear. Coolgardie's got lots of historical plaques. ashes to ashes, dust to dust, about the Kalgoorlie cemetery. Many people died in the early days from typhoid and were buried in unmarked graves. There's also a number of very famous Australian explorers buried here. There's a lot of people who died young, kids in their infancy, or only a few years old, or people who died in accidents down in the mines, or on the woodline railroads. Between the years 1894 and 1899, there were 1,108 burials. From 1961 to 1966, there were only 43. An early prospector, from 1992, there was a vast influx of young men, all carrying similar equipment. The lure of gold nuggets on the surface provided a powerful motivational force. The gold was there to be found, and it was found. Some remarkable discoveries. Gold and nickel is still being excavated from Coolgardie today. An early sketch of the rust of prospectors. From an historical perspective, the Coolgardie gold find proved to be of immense national significance. During the 1890s, Eastern Australia was in the grip of a severe depression, and fortune seekers flocked to the Coolgardie fields in the hope of a better life. Not only did these gold seekers discover the rich pickings they sought, but many died of thirst and waterborne diseases such as typhoid. Despite early hardships, within a short space of 10 years, Coolgardie's population mushroomed to 16,000 people. Entitled A.P. Brophy, Prospector, Riding the Camel, Misery, Coolgardie, 1895. Many prospectors couldn't afford camels. It's much more primitive in the transport, pedestrian, mobile. Dry blowers, Coolgardie. These dry blowers separate gravel from the gold naturally without the need for water, and believe it or not, they're still manufactured and sold today. Dry blowing in Coolgardie, 1898. Prospecting for gold in Five Flats, Coolgardie. During the early years, Coolgardie served as a base for exploring the gold-bearing potential of the surrounding red desert country. With the assistance of Afghan camel drivers, prospectors probed deep into the desert, searching for the ever-elusive alluvial gold deposits. Typically, the Afghan cameleers would charge prospectors a going rate of a chewing a day to carry essential miners' supplies. Camels were an indispensable part of the gold fields in the 1890s. Carrying food, water, machinery, and other supplies, they helped keep the towns going. In 1898, there were 300 Muslims in Coolgardie. By the year of the 1890s, Coolgardie was becoming a town covered in tents. It rapidly expanded to more permanent housing. Bailey's reward under the shaft, Coolgardie. The growth of population meant that large companies moved in and rapidly put the mines underground and established large batteries to stamp the ore and process. Shafts in the beginning were dangerous, primitive, and highly unsafe. These primitive methods were rapidly replaced by much more modern and safe methods. The development of mines led to better housing. An original primitive house covered in brushwood. Early development of the town, 1894, 2 years after the discovery of gold. Cobb and Company provided stagecoach transport prior to the railway. 1897. By 1900, Coolgardie had become a substantial city with large buildings and a burgeoning trade. Water proved a huge problem, and water was obtained by condensing groundwater by boiling it, an enormous expensive procedure that burned up all the surrounding trees. These condensers, as they were called, became enormous structures, highly expensive to operate. Obviously, a better solution was needed if the gold rush was to continue, and one was found. It's really unbelievable to look at these early 1900 photographs to see how the town had grown in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of an isolated desert. Coolgardie School of Mines, located on the corner of Hunt and Sylvester Streets. Notice the distinctive cone on the front of this building. A front view of the Chamber of Mines, School of Mines rather. The Atlas Chamber on Bailey Street, Coolgardie, completed in 1896. the warden's court, Coolgardie. Desert gold. Some of the recent buildings that survived the years are pictured on the stamps at the bottom. A general store in Coolgardie with shopkeepers. R. Pitchford's hairdressing saloon, Coolgardie. Businesses also developed. In 1896, the staff of a newspaper called the Golden Hope in Coolgardie. Like another entrepreneur of the same era, Francis Craig, Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario, Canada, who built the Algoma Steel Company and a railway. C.Y. O'Connor, a Perth entrepreneur, deepened the Fremantle Harbour, built a railway to service the gold fields, and installed a pipeline to pump water to service the gold fields. The old Coolgardie Railway Station was completed in 1896 and can be seen today. The railway station today is a museum and features the plight of an Italian miner by name of Modesto Farischetti, who in 1907 spent 9 days underground trapped in a collapsed mine and was rescued. By 1897, the stagecoach was no longer meeting the needs of the community. Condensers as well failed to provide adequate water for the growing community. C.Y. O'Connor commenced the dam at Mundaring Weir, the dam, the Mundaring River, and create a reservoir of water that could be piped to the gold fields. He also commenced a railway. With the railway came a pipeline, which was completed in 1904 to Kalgoorlie through Coolgardie. The railway, of course, ensured the survival of the gold fields, providing much cheaper manufacturing equipment and produce. The construction of roads was a slow and half-hearted affair. Roads did not replace the railway for transport till the mid-1900s. By the early 1900s, gold began to decrease, and by World War I, the town was in serious decline. The federal electorate was abolished in 1913 due to the diminished population. The population slipped to 200 people, and Coolgardie became a virtual ghost town. In March 1896, Coolgardie's main street was lit by electric light. By April 1924, the same street was lit by 4 hurricane lamps. The remains of old mining are clearly apparent, but many new mines and open pits are under development. New open pits are clearly apparent around Coolgardie by looking at Google Earth. The Shire of Coolgardie continues to host the mining industry. There's more than 20 mining and processing companies operating throughout the Shire. Goldfield St. Ives Mine, south of Lake Lefroy, is the third largest gold producer in Australia, while many large nickel producers are enjoying high prices. The rising price of gold is also stimulating exploration. Well, let's have a look at the flora before we finish up. Coolgardie is in an area called Coolgardie Woodlands, characterized by poor drainage and sandy weathered soils that have few nutrients. However, the plants seem to survive in these harsh soil conditions, with diverse woodlands rich in endemic eucalypts growing on the region's low limestone hills, while scrubs grow on the sand plains. It's a wide variety of fauna, including this brush-tail possum. Echidna, or spiny anteaters, are common. Barking owls sound very much like dogs barking during their hunting at night. Male e-birds construct large nests to control the temperature of their eggs. Here's the male e-bird that constructs the nest. The desert death adder delivers copious amounts of venom, but fortunately it's very frightened of humans and very seldom bites humans unless badly provoked. Thanks, dear visitor, for joining me on this historical tour of Coolgardie. Coolgardie is well worth a stopover for a day or two to look at its fascinating gold rush and ghost town history. It thrives as a small tourist center. Have a great day.